Good morning, Your Excellency Minister Fischer, Ambassador Nakane, Mr. Priest and Mr. Goldman. Thank you very much for inviting me first to this distinguished forum. I'm really I'm obliged that ECFR is taking a special interest on the relationship with Japan. Mr. Priest, in his opening remarks, in a very, very succinct manner, but in a very excellent way, summarized what the world today is. So I won't go too much detail into that. And of course, Minister Fischer eloquently demonstrated why the relationship between Europe and Japan is so important. Asia and Europe, ladies and gentlemen, are integral part of each other in security and economics. Japan stands with European nations in the fight against terrorism that challenge our civil society. Asian and European securities are inseparable. Since the turn of the century, the world has been fraught with more complexities, risks, even terrors, uncertainties, inequalities, and contradictions. In a sense, we are suffering from the backlash of the globalization. The world today, where powerful lawless organizations exist, has entered an age where it has become impossible for a country to protect its own safety and interest by itself. Everyone is protecting everyone else. In view of this, Prime Minister Abe passed a series of security legislations in September that do not only allow Japan to strengthen its self-defense, but also enable Japan to broadly engage in the international peace-building process. For example, PKO participation will become easier for Japan. For example, Japan will be able to provide security to the residents in conflict areas beyond simply offering humanitarian aid. I must emphasize here, though, that the important Article 9 of the Constitution firmly exists still. It is intact. This means that the basic character of Japan as a nation that has renounced the war forever remains unchanged. The security environments in Europe and Asia are increasingly severe. In Asia, we are seeing one-sided status quo changes in the South China Sea and East China Sea under the aggressive Chinese expansionism. In Europe, Russia has invaded Ukraine. Both Japan and Europe oppose attempts to change legal and political boundaries with force, and both are committed to protect international rules. On the economic front, the world is still unstable. The world economy is slowing, while growth acceleration is unable to escape deflation. The deceleration of large emerging countries such as China is becoming increasingly serious. The accumulation of excessive investment and debts after the financial crisis of 2008 was so great that to this day, the world has still not been able to absorb the anomaly. Japan and Europe both have the difficult task to restore the balanced development of world economy. The structures of Japan and Europe are quite similar. Both have long histories. Both have densely populated and compact societies. Both have no significant mineral or energy resources, and the effective use of resources has become a critical task. In terms of issues associated with urbanization and recycling resources, Japan has a considerable amount of technology to share with Europe. Facing the declining birth rate and aging population, Japan has become the world's experimental field, as it were, and Japan can transfer its experiences and wisdoms to Europe, like how to build a new industry fitted for the senior society. Meanwhile, there is a lot Japan can learn from Europe, such as structural reform, especially on taxation and labor market, long-term planning and portfolio changes of European corporations, successful cooperation between public and private sector on technological innovation in Europe, ICT strategies such as Industry 4.0 and so forth. As the relationship between Japan and individual European countries varies from one to another, I would today like to talk about Japan's relationship with Germany. In a very frank terms, perhaps you've never heard of before. There's a scene I still remember well It was February 3rd, 2004, just after the Iraqi war. Prime Minister Junichiro Koizumi had earlier sent former Prime Minister Ryutaro Hashimoto to Europe to discuss how Japan and Europe could jointly reconstruct Iraq. And this was a time when Minister Fischer was at the helm of German diplomacy. Mr. Hashimoto had sent an invitation to Chancellor Schroeder for a dinner at Ambassador Takashima's residence in Berlin. As it was unheard of for a German chancellor to come to the Japanese ambassador's residence for dinner, Mr. Hashimoto had to use some bait. Knowing that Chancellor Schroeder was a connoisseur of Japanese sake or rice wine, he had ordered the finest sake from Japan. I was watching from across the table, Chancellor Schroeder never taking his hands off the sake bottle during the entire dinner. When the dinner was finished, so was the two large bottles of sake. Ambassador Takashima, who had his eyes on this rare sake and was hoping to drink whatever was left over, was truly disappointed. Now, during the dinner, Chancellor Schroeder said something that I never forget. He said, Japan and Germany share the same fate. Either we both succeed or we both fail. That's why we need to cooperate with each other. To this date, there exists a strong sense of partnership among the leaders of the two countries. However, I must now tell you about the difficult reality between Japan and Germany. Japanese people love Germany. Many Japanese citizens still consider Germany to be a comrade that fought the Second World War together as allies. A BBC survey of last year shows that 46% of Japanese people feel mainly positive towards Germany, and only 3% have mainly negative views about Germany. On the other hand, Germans have a completely different perspective. My personal impression is that to German citizens, Japan is perceived as a country who collaborated with the Nazis to lead Germany to destruction. Only 28% of Germans feel mainly positive about Japan, according to the same survey, while a much higher number, 46%, feel mainly negative about Japan. Now, I am, of course, disappointed in these figures, but Japan needs to reflect upon itself. And this is a matter of reconciliation that Minister Fischer had mentioned. This year marks the 70th anniversary since the end of the World War II, and there have been many discussions in Japan about the past. On August 14th, Prime Minister Abe issued a statement summarizing the war and the 70-year history since then. It was an impressive statement. He expressed an apology and repentance for the war and reiterated the Japanese determination to continue moving forward as a peaceful nation. During the process, as a member of the commission that made recommendations to the Prime Minister, I was often in contact with Mr. Abe's thoughts directly and knew that his commitment to peace is unwavering. But the unfortunate truth is that 70 years after the war, we are still unable to come to reconciliation with neighboring countries. As a nation, Japan has repeatedly expressed its apology. From the late 50s to the early 60s, Japan also paid the war reparation to Asian countries, sometimes reaching almost 30% of its national budget. But notwithstanding the repeated expression of apology or payment, Japan's neighbors, China and Korea, do not show the sign of acceptance. I know we must continue to seek the way for the final reconciliation. And I must share one personal episode with you. And this is what happened this July in Los Angeles. I happened to sit on a board of a large Japanese company who used to own coal and copper mines during the wartime. And we had to accept American POWs, so the so-called white POWs, consisting of Americans, Brits, Dutch, and Australians. And we subjected them to a servitude under very inhuman condition. I felt the need to apologize. Talked with my colleagues in the company, and they all agreed that we must extend our apology. So we went to Los Angeles. It was a moving moment. The president of the American POW Association, upon seeing us, bowed his head to us, saying that this is the second time he's bowing his head to Japanese. The first was 70 years ago. He had to do so out of fear, because he would be subjected to violence. The second time, this time, he's bowing out of the respect for Japanese who came all the way, had the courage come to apologize the POWs. I almost wanted to cry. And my repentance was that, why couldn't we have done this earlier when there were still more survivors? And I also felt very, very strongly that apologies must be met with forgiveness in order to come to reconciliation. And it is only the survivors, the sufferers themselves, who went through this tremendous agony that can extend such forgiveness. Not their children, not their families, but the sufferers themselves. And for that, we have not much time left. We are not meeting with generous neighbors. Mr. Xi Jinping came to Berlin last year and was on a tirade demonizing Japan, what we did in the city of Nanjing. China is propagating in Africa to really naive African people that bellicosity is still in the blood of Japanese, showing the pictures of 80 years ago in Nanjing. Now, of course, there is no excuse for Japan to justify what we did in the city of Nanjing. No, as a matter of fact, what we did in China. It was a clear act of a violent invasion, but it was something long time ago. But we're not still forgiven. Chancellor Merkel came to Japan this year and explained how Germany is having an excellent relationship in Europe, aided by France. For Japan, China was not France. For Japan, France was the United States. But unfortunately, the US, of course, has a limited influence over formulating the feeling among Asian countries to come to reconciliation with Japan. But still, having said all that, my frank view is that we are behind Germany in strongly facing the guilt of the wrong war. By whom and why the war was started, how it was escalated, and why we could not stop it earlier. The extent of how serious a nation reflects on its past is symbolized in how much determination is put into relaying the truth about its history to children through education. I personally think Japanese education is lacking on this point. How we invaded China, how we caused havoc to China, how we annexed Korea, and how we deprived Korean national identity. We have yet to tell in full scale what we did to our children. The students that I teach at university ask me, Professor, how long do we have to keep apologizing to China and Korea? For them, the acts of war were something not conducted by their grandfathers. It's by their great-grandfathers, or perhaps great-great-grandfathers. So I think these youngsters must be freed from the perpetual sense of atonement about the war. Yet at the same time, we as a nation must convey the truth, the historical truth, even if it is something unfavorable for Japan, through education to children transcending generations, and firmly embed that those reflections into the Japanese DNA. If and only when we succeed in doing that, I think the feeling of German citizens towards Japan will improve. Thank you very much.